Good afternoon. My name is Linda Rieke, and I'll be moderating today's Water Research Foundation webcast on the Project 4321, Pressure Management, Industry Practices and Monitoring Procedures. The Water Research Foundation funded this project in 2010 as a direct follow-on to the Foundation AWWA Partnership Project 4109, Criteria for Optimized Distribution Systems. The Criteria Project identified pressure management as one of three optimization criteria for distribution systems, and then identified performance measures for pressure management. The Criteria Project outcomes help support the expansion of the AWWA Partnership for Safe Water to include distribution system excellence. This follow-on project, 4321, resulted in some additional findings that support possible modifications to the Criteria Project recommendations. This project was also responsive to one of the 10 high priority research needs from the Research and Information Collection Partnership with the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. That research need was to survey distribution system pressure management practices to help establish a better understanding of current water utility practices. You may know that pressure management in distribution systems was a key consideration in the 2006 National Research Council report on drinking water distribution systems, assessing and reducing risks. Pressure management in distribution systems has been and continues to be an area of focus at the Foundation, and we have funded over 12 research projects on this topic. The project to be presented today provides us with a better understanding of pressure management practices under both baseline and optimized conditions in drinking water utilities in the United States. The research presents case studies from small, medium, and large water utilities both before and after implementing optimized pressure management and monitoring. The case studies help to illustrate that optimal pressure management can help protect water quality, reduce leaks and main breaks, and save money through reduced energy use, maintenance, leakage, and customer complaints. The principal investigator, Mark LeChevalier, is here today to present the project key results and findings. This webcast will be 60 minutes with a 50-minute presentation and a 10-minute question and answer after the presentation. If you have questions during the presentation, feel free to submit them at any time by typing them into the question box at the bottom of your screen. We will then answer the questions after the presentation, and if we're unable to answer everyone's questions during today's webcast, early next week we'll make the written answers available on the Foundation website. Also, if you have a colleague that wants to view this webcast and is unable to do so right now, it will be available for viewing next week on the Foundation website. Finally, the report is available to download from the Foundation website, and requests for the print report will be mailed out next week. Well, I'm now pleased to introduce today's presenter. Dr. Mark LeChevalier is the Director of Innovation and Environmental Stewardship for American Water, a water utility that operates in more than 30 states and Canada and serves over 15 million people. He received his Bachelor of Science and Master's degrees in microbiology from Oregon State University and his PhD in microbiology from Montana State University. Dr. LeChevalier has authored over 100 research papers and has received awards from the American Water Works Association for outstanding contributions to the science of water treatment. He was a recipient of the George Warren Fuller Award and the Abel Wohlman Award from the American Water Works Association, and he is a fellow of the American Academy of Microbiology. Welcome, Mark. I'll turn it over to you now.
Great. Thanks, Linda. Good afternoon, everyone. Well, when we think about how important pressure is, and you see the dialing cogs in the wheel, that's what happens when you have some of your staff help you prepare the slides. When you think about important pressure is how it's important to providing safe water, how it affects the physical integrity of our pipes, how pressure is really energy, and energy costs us money, you would think that for all these reasons, managing and maintaining and monitoring pressure in our distribution systems would be one of our top jobs. I think what we'll show you from some of the survey and some of the data we collected, that as in this industry, we could probably do better in this regard. And and when we pay attention to pressure and pressure management, we can reap a lot of benefits, actually far more benefit than the effort that it takes to put into this. But we know, for example, if in developing countries, one of the main problems they have with water quality is not that the water is not properly treated, but because they have electricity only maybe for a few hours a day, they lose pressure in the system, and then contaminants can enter into the distribution system. That's what really causes a lot of the waterborne disease in developing countries. Also, fluctuations in pressure, and this is something we've researched with the foundation for about 15 years now, can cause pressure transients, and they could either be high pressures that could burst apart pipes and cause main breaks and increase leakage, but they also could produce low pressure events, which could draw contamination into system through any leaks. And in fact, all of that variation in pressure can help put stresses on the pipe and reduce the life of our asset. And given the fact that we have between $300 million to $1 billion of infrastructure need just over the next 20 years, it's a shame that, you know, we're putting assets in and maybe not taking care of them as well by focusing on pressure management. And then likewise, reduce energy costs, reduce system maintenance, less leakage, less main breaks, fewer water quality problems, fewer customer complaints, all can save utility money in their operations. As Linda explained, this project is a follow-on to this project that was a principal investigator on that one was Melinda Friedman, which we published this report in 2010 on criteria for optimized distribution systems. And the graph here shows that, you know, distribution, disinfectant residuals, main breaks, and pressure managements were really the three legs of which an optimized distribution system could be considered. And that's because each of these, just like shown on this graph here, pressure management, distribution, disinfectant residuals, and main breaks, when we consider those three, it touches on many other aspects of distribution system operations. For example, here, pressure control could have us focus on our main breaks. It can have us focus on how we manage our storage tanks, how we conduct our flushing program, how we focus on our water loss control. So pressure management touches on all of those. And so if we're going to do a thorough job in evaluating pressure management, it really starts touching on all aspects of distribution system operations. The outcome of that criteria document was to develop some goals for optimized pressure management, maintain greater than 0 PSI under emergencies and 20 PSI under max day and fire flow conditions, 35 PSI on normal conditions, and less than 100 PSI under normal conditions, and variations in pressure plus or minus about 10 PSI. Now, those were recommendations that had come from a work group, and part of that recommendation also was to have two pressure recorders in each pressure zone placed at the minimum, expected minimum and maximum pressure locations. Now, these results look good on paper, but actually how well do they play out in real-life practice was the objective of this study. And so this project 4321 had four different tasks: to conduct a utility survey, which we will talk about. We'll show some data on the comparison of the baseline, which we say is the existing, whatever pressure monitoring utilities were doing, we call that the existing baseline. And we compare that to this optimized pressure monitoring following the recommendations on the previous project with two recorders at optimum locations, the expected high and low within a pressure zone. And then we'll integrate those pressure management data with other distribution activities and demonstrate how the cost of an optimized pressure monitoring and management program can be offset by cost reductions and other system operations, and eventually develop best practices. So the first part was a utility survey. As Linda also alluded to, we surveyed 36 utilities, but a fairly good cross-section of small, medium, and large systems. Some of those characteristics are shown here. So one utility that only had 400 connections, another one that had over 400,000 connections, served population about 1,000 over a population of 2.5 million. So we got a pretty good cross-section of these systems. Also, they serve surface, groundwater, or mixed sources of supply. And we asked these utilities, do you have a goal or criteria for maintenance of pressure in distribution systems? And most of the systems said, 95% of it, yes, we, under fire flow, we try to maintain 20 PSI, which reflects the 10 state standards and typical operating conditions for most systems. Then we asked them, under emergency conditions, what are your goals for pressure management? And here about 68% said, well, we try to maintain 20 PSI, and the remainder said we try to at least maintain positive pressure in the distribution system, which again is very similar to utility practice. However, that's the last point where we find unanimous agreement in the utilities. For example, we asked them, do you have criteria or goal for high pressures in your system? And you can see about two-thirds of the system said, no, we don't have any particular goal. And others said, well, we try to maintain pressure less than 175, 200, 320 PSI. So not a lot of uniformity as far as trying to maintain to manage high pressures in distribution systems. Then we asked utilities, well, where do you monitor your pressure? And here we found that most of the systems, 87%, monitor at points that we call convenient locations. These are typically locations that utilities own and can manage, sites like pump stations or storage tanks or a pressure-reducing valve location or some other site that the utility owns. And only 13% of the pressure monitoring locations are in areas we would call targeted locations, that they were selected at a meter or a hydrant in an area that was a particular concern to the utility. So we don't have a lot of uniformity in where utilities monitor, particularly to try to find optimum locations. This next graph shows data on how many pressure zones utilities had. And actually, this data matches results from the US EPA Community Water Survey and the fact that the average system, the median system in our survey, had between 5 and 6 pressure zones, and that matches national data from the US EPA really well. The average system in the United States has about 5 or 6 pressure zones. In our data, the 90th percentile had about 50 pressure zones. But we did have one system that had 175 pressure zones. So managing pressure in some of these systems can be a more formidable task when you have 175 pressure zones to make sure that you're meeting these pressure goals in all of those zones. We asked the utilities the survey asked about your largest two pressure zones, and then we asked about the smallest two pressure zones. can get either end of that spectrum, as we didn't want to collect data from 175 pressure zones. And so when we, this next slide tabulates that data, from the smallest pressure zones, are your pressure monitors permanently installed? And we broke down the data by the number of pressure zones. So those that have a few pressure zones between 1 and 6 can see 67% of them said, yes, we have permanent locations. Another 17% said sometimes they're permanent, sometimes they're not. And 17% of them said, no, we don't have permanent recorders in our smaller zone. And you can see that no answer increases to 43% when there's utilities with more than 11 pressure zones. So it's not the practice in the industry, at least based on these data, that utilities necessarily monitor pressure in every pressure zone of their system. How would we know that we're providing adequate pressure if we don't actually monitor? Some opportunities for improvement. The next slide here asks the utilities, well, how often do you calibrate your pressure zone and the pressure monitors? And you can see the data range from 1 to 6 months to annually to as needed, and about 30% of them said, you know what, we're supposed to calibrate these pressure recorders, because they said they never had calibrated. We probably could add the other 10% over here that, you know, to that same group says, well, we calibrate them only on an as-needed basis, which probably means we never get around to doing it. And we asked the utilities, when you do record pressure, what is the recording interval? Is it seconds or minutes or a series of minutes, 5 minutes, 15 minutes, hour? We had about 12% of them say, well, we collect one pressure measurement a day, and that's pretty much good for us. So you can see these data show that there's quite a bit of variation. The next slide shows what happens when we change from monitoring in 1 hour period. That's the data shown here. And for this system, the pressures look pretty consistent, a little bit of variation, a few blips here and there, but nothing really unusual in pressure monitoring. But if we change that pressure monitoring interval to 2 minutes, you can see that we see quite a bit more of things going on to the system, a lot more low peaks, dips in pressure during the system. Now, these pressures are always maintained above 20 psi, but if this utility only collected data on hourly intervals, they wouldn't know that these things were happening. And without that information, they would never know what to go look for or find out what might be causing these variations in pressure in their system. So more frequent monitoring would be would be recommended. So that's some of the results from our survey. It says that, you know, as an industry, we probably have opportunities to up our game on pressure monitoring, do calibrations, put monitors at critical locations, collect data on a more frequent basis. So the second task of this is so we went into 20 utilities, and we installed pressure monitors at those critical locations, collecting data on routine basis. And the question is, well, if we did that, what are we going to find? How does that compare to that baseline monitoring? So we put two pressure loggers in each zone, and we collected the data and compared that to the recommendations that came from the Project 4109. Our baseline was what the utilities were already collecting, and our optimized is what the recommendations in 4109 would have called for. For here's just an example. Here's a schematic of a distribution system. The plant is over here on the right side, and with the red triangle. The current pressure monitoring is in the effluent of the plant, So it basically tells us the high service pumps are probably on. And that ends up being an area of the highest pressure in the system. Then it pumps across this entire gradient all the way up into this area where there's a storage tank and on the northern part of this plant where they have another pressure monitor, which basically tells you how much was water in the tank. So based on the recommendations from 4109, which is to put pressure recorders at the highest and lowest pressure in the system, but far away from influencing locations like pumps or storage tanks or control valves, we would recommend the optimized location to be in this area of high pressure near the plant, but away from the plant. And so we show that this purple box, blue box here. And at the optimum low pressure, which would be in the same high zone here, but farther away from the tank. So it's not just influenced by water levels in the tank. And this could then supplement well with other points of monitoring in the system. So that kind of understanding of how we basically sat down with each utility, looked at the pressure zone we were monitoring, and did the same kind of analysis. What's the areas of highest pressure, lowest pressure? Where's the current monitors? Where would we recommend putting these optimized locations? And here's an example. Here's a site, one of the participating sites in Colorado. This system already had six pressure monitors in this test zone, and they're shown at these locations with the red arrows. It's a pretty busy slide, so maybe a little bit hard to see, but you can see right now they seem to cover the range of areas in the distribution system fairly well. But when we went into the system and sat down with that utility and chose the optimized locations, they would be at these locations. Up here in the northern part of the pressure zone would be the area of lowest pressure, and here in the middle of the pressure zone would be the areas of high pressure. And let's just look at the comparison of the kind of results we would get. Now here's the data, several months of data from those six conventional pressure monitoring. So we see the system, a number of areas of the location running, looks like around 130, 140 PSI, with one part of the system running about 70 PSI and fairly consistent. But when we throw in the data on the optimized monitoring, we find that, in fact, the areas of the highest part of the system is actually running above 160 PSI, and the low area of that system is running maybe about 50 PSI with a little bit, some types of evidence of some transients in that system. Not a terribly different picture in this regard, but starts to tell you that bounding those pressure monitors with these optimized locations, we would know that other areas of the system are in pressures in areas in between. Maybe we don't need six pressure monitors. We could get that same information from two. So let's look at another system. Here's a participating location in Virginia. We're going to see that same location. Their conventional monitoring was at a storage tank here, tank 591. And looking at the system, we would recommend the low pressure monitoring at this location and the high pressure monitoring at this location. So when we look at the profile we'd get from monitoring at the tank, it's very consistent. It'd basically be influenced by the filling and draining of the tank. When in fact this system had a lot more going on in the distribution system, we see the area of high pressure is actually routinely above 100 PSI with some transients up to about 150 PSI, and the area of low pressure having quite a bit of variation, and again sometimes around 20 PSI or maybe just a tad lower, depending on some type of events. So monitoring in these two locations would tell the utility they have a lot more going on than just what the level of water is in the storage tank. And so having that investment of a pressure monitor, but having it at the right location, can yield far more useful information to utility to understand what's going on in their distribution system. A couple more here is an example in California, and we show you already what the optimized low and high pressure monitoring locations in this system. And this utility would rely on their tank levels convert their tank levels into PSI, and we can see the data from the tank is pretty unremarkable. Maybe just a slight dip here in the in January or so. At least on my screen, it's a little bit hard to see in the yellow, but we see that during that time we have some kind of dip in pressure. And in fact, during that event, a contractor had ruptured a water main, and we did see a pressure dip in pressure during that time. And so it tells us that monitoring the tank levels is not as sensitive as monitoring pressure in the distribution system. But if we now add the data from the optimized high location, we can see that the pressure, in fact, this system was generally above 140 psi with a dip during this main break. But at the optimized low pressure, we can see that the pressure has actually got down to maybe 5 or 10 psi in this parts of the system, in the area of low pressure in that system during this 4-inch main break. One last example from Texas. Again, we're showing the areas of optimized high and low pressure in this system compared to the conventional monitors they would have, and which are located here at storage tanks. And again, the data from pressure monitors located near the storage tanks are pretty unremarkable, pretty flat, a little bit of variation. We see one anomaly here, and it turns out that this was a time when the monitor was taken offline for maintenance, so it's not a really loss of pressure during this particular event. But when we look at the optimized high and low locations, we see a lot of things going on in this system. The area of high pressure shows quite a bit of variation. Although the average is around 100 psi, we see sometimes it's down to 50 or 60 psi, and very frequently up as high as 140 psi. So this is all associated with localized demand, use of different users, customers on in this Texas system. But simply knowing that this kind of variation is going on, and these kinds of spikes could be related to increased stress on pipes, increased frequency of main breaks, definitely provides insights to the utility that they wouldn't have had just from the pressure monitors located next to the storage tanks. So the results of the second phase of the study around comparison of optimized pressure monitoring to conventional monitoring shows that optimized monitoring really gives us much more valuable insights into activities that be resulting in pressure variations in the system. So our third task is then, well, how do we, if we do this, how do we leverage this data to, we're going to make an investment to putting pressure monitors in every one of our pressure zones. That's going to cost us money. Are we going to save anything by having this information? And the short answer is absolutely. There's tremendous cost savings when we integrate our pressure monitoring into our distribution system activities. For example, here in results of one of the utilities, found that their a recommendation, they could change their pump settings. The conventional monitor at the pumps discharge showed that the pressure was typically about 145 psi at the discharge of the pumps, and the locations in the distribution system are generally about 60 to 80 psi. So we did analysis of that system and proposed that if they reduce their pump discharge by 7 psi, they could result in decrease their water loss by 10 to 15%. They would reduce their main break frequency, and they would save some costs on energy usage. Interesting, in this utility, though, they were really concerned that the customers were sensitive to pressure, and you know, and that their water revenue might go down if they reduce the pressure, and so they decided not to take this recommendation. But I would encourage them to continue to look at that and maybe consider that. I don't think that customers would actually even recognize a 7 psi difference in pressure, and yet the operating benefits of this would be significant. Another example that is discussed in the report was results that wasn't part of the system. Philadelphia was a participating utility and helped provide this information. But here was some work that George Kunkel had done on developing a demand district metered area shown here in the red. So the utility went in and isolated this area and could monitor pressures and flows into this zone of the system. And they modulated the flow. They reduced the flow pressures in this, particularly at night, to reduce some of the peaks in pressure. So it shows that this graph shows that the pressure were reduced from about 100 psi down to maybe about 70 psi, and that reduced their water loss from the minimum night flows from about 300 gallons down to under 100 gallons by managing and reducing the pressure. Of course, leaks leak less when they're under lower pressure. And the savings of this, they calculated, was going to result in savings over $100,000 and have a payback of about 6 years from doing this pressure management, creating this zone within their system, with a rate of return of about 9%, so not a bad return on investment. Another case study discussed in the report shows how we might overlay multiple pieces of data. Of course, it's pressure, managing pressure is sometimes only one of the components related to management and distribution system. So this case study from Tennessee overlaid pressure and the type of pipes, and we'll show you that here in just a moment. So this graphic here shows in the, these are all yellow dots, areas where the pressure is greater than 100 psi in this system, because it tends to be very hilly. And the red dots is kind of hard to see, but some parts of it you can see in this southern area and this isolated area over on the lower left have some dots where the pressure is more than 200 psi in this system. So our optimized low pressure monitoring would be shown here at 40 psi, and the high monitoring at these locations at showed the pressure about 200 psi. So in analyzing the system of what's driving main breaks, we looked at the area of high pressure, and that's shown in this graphic here, and we overlaid it with characteristics around the size of the pipe and the type of pipe material. And these zones of the system tend to have older unlined cast iron mains, which tend to break fairly frequently. they weren't necessarily always in the areas of highest pressure. And then we overlaid all of the main break data shown here in the lower left-hand side. And we did this hotspot analysis, which was is outlined in the reports, but it's pretty slick. We're basically looking at how much do these areas deviate from an average. And the larger average deviation, the stronger the color is. So we can see some areas where we have higher rates of main breaks than the rest of the system, and did analysis of the role of pressure and type of pipe material in these particular locations. And we found, shown in this graph here, that pressure is only one of the components, but it was a component that the utility could control and manage, and that it showed for about every 10 a change in 10 psi in a pressure in the system, they could reduce the main breaks by about tenfold. And so certainly areas of higher pressure tended to have higher rates of main breaks. So by managing water pressures in the system could be a key factor to bringing down the system average of 39 breaks per 100 miles per year down at least about a 10% reduction. And often when we think about main breaks and we think about the cost of main breaks, we're thinking about the cost of the repairing the mains, maybe overtime and crews. This case study looked at insurance claims because oftentimes some of the biggest costs is not actually repairing the main break or necessarily the loss of water, but it's the damage main break occurs to nearby property. And so this graphic here shows, summarizing some of the costs of main breaks. You can see here in the light blue, the actual labor and materials room to repair the main is the smallest component. The insurance claims are shown here in yellow, and some of the costs of repaving the streets are shown here in the blue. So some of the ancillary costs are actually far more greater than just fixing the pipe. So we did some graphic overlying insurance claims along with main breaks and pressures in this system to show that that reducing pressure in the system could result in significant reductions due to insurance claims. So another benefit from pressure management. In the previous study of this, it's outlined in the report, they reduced pressures in the system from 179 psi to 145 psi. That resulted in a 60% reduction in main breaks. In fact, they were able to redirect one crew that was just going out and doing main repairs to doing other preventive maintenance. And they had a 30% reduction in non-revenue water and water loss and a $1.4 million a year cost savings. You can see the reduction in costs. And so this the case study looking at the next opportunity of further reducing the pressure in the system comes with a change, change in the treatment plant and further reductions in pressure in the system. Finally, one of the case studies in this system looked at the opportunity to rezone a distribution system. Here, this graphic looks familiar. It was our example of pressure monitoring in the beginning, where the treatment plant is here on the right-hand side, and you can see the dots with red being the highest pressures on this part of the system, having pressures greater than 100 psi. The blues are 75 to 100 psi. The greens are 35 to, the light greens, light yellows are 35 to or 20 to 35 psi here at the high elevations. We did analysis of this system looking at their capital, their O&M costs, and suggested that we would create a new pressure gradient suggested here in the middle, and we would create a new boundary for this system. And at least on a paper study, did an evaluation of four different alternatives. Won't go through all of those details. They're outlined in the report. Sufficient to say that the one recommendation was to rezone the system and to install variable frequency drives at the treatment plant would save this utility from their energy cost saving from about $1.2 million a year in energy down to just a little under $500,000. So almost a $700,000 a year savings in energy costs could more than offset over, the net present value of the cost of rezoning this this distribution system. So don't underestimate the impact of pumping against a high head in the distribution system by rezoning those systems could result in significant cost savings. So what's the future of pressure management? Many states are starting to place greater emphasis on requirements for pressure management. In our survey, we found that most states had some requirement that utilities monitor pressure, but where do they monitor pressure? How do they monitor? What's the frequency? How do they respond to those pressure variations? Most states and most utilities didn't have any uniform requirements. Some states are starting to put greater focus on that. Since this project is finished, we now are starting on a project that's with an Israeli company looking at pressure management through pressure-reducing valves. That technology is most commonly used when you tend to have many pressure zones, for example, in hilly areas, and looking at an automatic technology that could reduce the pressure at night, not by a lot, but again, 5, 10, 15 psi change in pressure, particularly at night when customers are not using water anyway, can have substantial savings in reducing main breaks and reducing water loss and providing data to help identify when mains break and being a proactive approach to asset management. The business case, the cost incentive for that are in the range of millions of dollars. So it's not an insignificant benefit when utilities place this kind of approach on their distribution system. As Linda had said, the US EPA in their information collection partnership around development of information for a possible future distribution system rule is also looking at pressure management. And they had particular areas around survey of distribution system pressure management practices. In fact, the survey in this project was envisioned that something that utilities could use as a tool. It had fairly easy radio buttons and drop-down menus that they could answer questions. Also, another project to characterize how pressure events are propagated, how they travel through distribution systems, creating these areas of high and low pressure, and develop strategies to help diagnose and monitor pressure fluctuations. So, of course, that strategy starts with having good monitoring and good information and developing a toolkit for pressure management. Linda also said the Partnership for Safe Water has recently launched a program for distribution system optimization. And one component of that optimization program is an element around pressure management. Now, that program partnership is still working, and it's going to be an evolving process for them, but we'll have a similar kind of approach around pressure management. So utilities today, those on the phone, don't have to wait till your state's main recommendations or the US EPA comes out some point in the future with the distribution system rule, if that ever happens. They can be proactive now, join the Partnership for Safe Water, enroll into the Distribution System Optimization Program, and start looking at their system for optimization of their water quality through disinfecting residuals, their assets through tracking and managing main breaks, and as we talked today about monitoring and managing their distribution system pressures. So to wrap up this part, and we'll have time for questions, just to remind you that pressure management is fundamental to protecting public health, maintaining our infrastructure, and effective utility management. I think for all of these things, we'd be really good at what we do, but I think today's presentation, the survey says, we probably have opportunities to up our game. And even though pressure monitoring is required by regulations, there's a lot of variations, not even necessarily requirements that we would annually calibrate the pressure recorders. Negative pressure events do occur due to main breaks and power outages, and so utilities should be aware that there are times that monitoring would be important. And this is pressure management has been identified by the US EPA and states for distribution system research, and so a utility that launches its own program for distribution system monitoring, like through the partnership, can, by putting the effort in this regard, can result in significant improvements in their operations through reduced non-revenue water, through reduced main breaks, improved customer service, reduced energy costs. So I just want to finish up by acknowledging the funding for this from the Water Research Foundation and the in-kind contributions from more than 30 utilities and the subsidiaries of American Water. Frank Blaha is our project manager, and you can see Bill Soucy, Graham McDonald, and Steve Rupart were our, on our project advisory committee, and we appreciate their oversight and comments on this project. But mostly I want to emphasize, acknowledge Jen Yang and Minhua Zhu, who are engineers that work for me on this project, and so they did all the analysis and heavy lifting on this project, and I really appreciate them. Dave Hughes on my staff and Norm Ansell in our engineering department helped with some of the project overviews. And then our partners, technical advisors on this project, George Kunkel from Philadelphia Water and Mike Hotelling from Newport News Waterworks also appreciated their input. But this project couldn't have been done with the without the participants of the 36 in the survey and the 20 utilities that collect the year-long pressure data, and we really tremendous thanks goes out to them for the willingness to take a good look at their systems and help all the industry better understand how pressure management can help in our operations. So with that, Linda, I'll turn that back to you do our question and answer period.
All right. I appreciate that, Mark. Thanks so much. And it did your presentation did generate a few questions, so we do have about 10 minutes to go through them. Let me start. In the survey that you administered as part of the project, what was considered an emergency, and how was it different from a situation where fire flow was provided?
Well, we ask questions, you know, typically systems are designed for fire flow and max, day demand. So that's typically one type of analysis that utilities can do. Other emergencies might be due to main breaks, unusual momentary changes in flow. Not to say that a fire flow isn't can't necessarily be an emergency, but that's something that most systems, design and can, plan for. A major main break, a transmission line, may not be something that they necessarily would know happened.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Why is a 2-minute interval considered to be ideal for the monitoring versus a 1-minute?
Yeah, good question. And the answer to this comes back to another project we did for the Water Research Foundation. And, you know, I don't call my projects by their number. There's too many of them. But this was a risk model around intrusion. And I don't know, Linda, if maybe we could find we'll post on the answers exactly what that link to that project report. But we found that a single event of a low pressure typically had a risk of 1 in 10,000, which EPA said is right around the acceptable risk for drinking water. So, and that duration of that event had about 10 seconds. So if we put that in order of magnitude higher and said it was 100 seconds, or that's really about a minute and a half, it's only within that you start to see any significant level of risk. So so we're not really interested in capturing the second-by-second variation. A minute or 2 minutes as far as monitoring would be in the right kind of range. And so the recommendations here are trying to balance collecting a ton of data so that you have warehouses filled with pressure recordings, and you know, so we don't have to collect it so often, but we collect it in a range where it provides useful information. So a minute or two is about right. 5 minutes, 15 minutes starts to be a little bit on the long side. What we do recommend is that the utilities would install pressure recorders, and we in the report outlines a number, you know, provides a survey of different available pressure recorders. We don't say that we necessarily got every one of them, but most of the major brands are listed there. But many of them can monitor pressure on a continuous basis, log that data every minute or two into the SCADA, so you keep records. But you can set the pressure recorder for an impulse so that once the pressure gets out of a particular range, let's say pressures drop below 20 psi, then I want to be collecting pressure recordings every second until the pressure gets back up to 20 psi. So you can do this kind of combination recording where you're logging data and everything is kind of normal and pressure is exactly where you expect it to do, and do these impulse readings when you have some kind of event happens in the system. And many of the commercial pressure recorders can handle this kind of dual monitoring, and that really gives you the best combination of having detailed information but not having warehouses of, you know, data collected every second.
Good point. That's good. Another question is, what specific criteria is used to find the best high and low pressure locations to install the monitors?
Yeah, that's
and,
a good...
And does the utility need to create a distribution system water model to do this?
They don't have to have a water model, although that helps. And if utilities don't have one, you know, a lot of the software now especially for smaller systems, one advantage of small systems, not very complicated. It's not very expensive nowadays to get a fairly decent, at least skeletalized model. So I would encourage systems to have that. They don't have it. But in fact, you know, most operators of their system know the areas that are problematic. Customers help by calling in with complaints of low pressure. So for most of them, they know those areas. A model can be helpful because it can tell you the expected high and low pressures, but sometimes that can be a localized area, zone that could be influenced by the size of piping, for example, as well as the terrain. So local knowledge and operator knowledge at the end of the day really becomes important. A model can be helpful and would encourage that, but certainly not necessary, particularly for the smaller systems. Most operators know, you know, where the problems areas are. Go put a monitor there and help you better manage that.
Mm-hmm. Do you recommend that the pressure recorders used for the monitoring have the ability to capture transients?
Like I just said, being able to capture those impulse readings around some kind of preset can be helpful. So in the previous project, 4109, on optimized distribution system, criteria, we didn't want to get into the area of research. And certainly, 4 or 5 years ago when that report was being developed, the questions around pressure transients were still being researched. That being said, if I was installing equipment and, spending money in installing that, I would probably want to know that if I had transients happening in my system, I would want to know when they have happened them, when they happen, what was triggering them, and how that I might be able to solve that. And so having that information is important. The other part is having it alarmed. So just having a recorder out, on the east end of town with a pressure wheel, and once a week you come and look at it, is not going to give you the kind of information. These have to have the telemetry and the programming to alarm you when something's happening in your system. So if I was going to make that investment in pressure monitoring, then I would definitely want to know, if I had particular transient events, either high transients, that high pressures, and or low pressures.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I should just mention that we are doing another project on backflowing water meters, and that goes hand in hand with that. While we may have few pressure monitors in the system, most systems have water meters for every customer, and we're looking at collecting that information as an adjunct to the pressure monitoring. And those results are that project's underway, and the results are coming out. We've done millions of meter reads for that project, and we have found literally thousands of backflowing meters. So keep an eye for that project, and we'll probably have a webcast on that in the future. But, we already have investment in water meters. We can use that information to, leverage that information to help us understand our distribution systems and improve our operations.
Mm-hmm. Here's a good question. What would you consider to be the single most important factor when considering all that you've studied for good pressure management?
One of those thought-provoking.
Right.
Well, I think the first part is to recognize this is important. I think what we've seen utilities is that, we manage pressure. We generally don't have customers calling us because, the pressures are really low. But we consider, as long as we maintain our tanks and have pressure in the system, things are okay. As we really look into this, a lot of the problems we have, our aging infrastructure is accelerating its aging because of variations in pressure management. Our, the average water loss in the United States is, 15 to 20%. That's being aggravated because we have high pressures. Main breaks and energy costs for utilities, because the pressure is energy and it comes from our pumps. All of this are important operational parameters for utilities. And we said, when we don't do that, we end up having main breaks. And it's not just fixing the main break, but it's the insurance costs on the property damage, it's the repaving of roads, all the other ancillary costs. Not paying attention to pressure management is costing us big time. So I think probably the one thing, that we could probably do best is, get in our heads that this is something that's worth our time and attention. And the payoffs here can be substantial.
Well, I thank you very much for sharing your knowledge with us today, Mark. That's been really good. And I do want to remind our listeners that the report, again, is available to download from our website. So thank you, Mark. And just a brief note to our participants that there is a short four-question survey that will be conducted right about now at the end of the webcast. Please do take a few minutes right now to complete the survey. So thanks again, Mark, and have a good day, everybody.
Thank you. Take care, everyone.